Hey witches, Tiffany here on Bewitched and Bemused. Today, let's talk casting circles, or as I personally like to call it, opening sacred space. Throughout time and across cultures and regions, the shape of the circle has held important significance and often sanctity. There are several stone circles that historians have linked to the worship of nature and the practice of magic. It is probably therefore no surprise that circle casting is not only a pretty common practice, but it's also a very introductory one. Today I'm going to cover what are the reasons for casting a circle, several different techniques of circle casting and how to do so, and then once you're done, how do you open up that circle and release it. If you prefer to reference back to this later on in a easy to follow list format, the article that corresponds with this video is linked down below in the description box. As is pretty much the case of everything within the craft, casting a circle is not necessarily something that everybody does and is certainly not a one size fits all technique. Some do it, some don't, and some, like myself, do it in certain cases and in others they don't bother. For me, I don't really bother with quick forms of divination or if I'm casting a quick charm, but if I'm doing a more elaborate ritual, or if I'm trying to contact spirit, then yeah, I might cast a circle. Most of the time it comes down to the path or tradition you follow, if you follow one. I myself do not, so therefore it also comes down to personal preference. Circles, magic, and otherwise, represent natural cycles. The cycle of life and nature around us that we celebrate with the wheel of the year, and with that, the solar cycle as well. They represent flow and movement, balance, unity, perfection, and infinity. Consider mandalas used for rituals and meditation, the circular clock and sundial, the yin and yang symbol. The circle is enclosed with no beginning and no end. It is perfect wholeness and symmetry. Now, for opening sacred space, the shape of the circle is the most popular type, I would say, but depending on your tradition or what you are doing in particular, there are often times where other shapes are used or recommended. Just putting that out there to have all of my bases covered, but we're not going to talk about all those today. Maybe for another video if that's something that you guys are interested in. But the circle is a versatile classic. I think every practitioner benefits from at least learning how to cast a circle and giving it a go, even if maybe they find it doesn't really work for them. You never know when it might come in handy in the future. Just kind of one of those foundational practices. The three top reasons that a practitioner might want to cast a circle is protection, energetic concentration, and setting the mood, so to speak. When I say protection, I am talking more so about outside influences and interference than I am about safety protection, although that can play a role, kind of depending on what you're doing. And it's not just protection for you as the caster, but also for whatever the working is that you're doing, the energy that you're putting into it, the energy that you're using for it, and just your general space. But yeah, if you're doing an invocation or spirit communication, it might come down to personal safety as well, or even just personal comfort. Another practitioner who may have active workings that are working against you. Trickster spirits, malevolent spirits, and just general negative energy are just a few examples of things that can interfere or influence what you're trying to manifest. By casting a circle, you are essentially setting up a boundary that says, "Do not cross." We'll also touch on this a little bit more later, but with that in mind, you can also sort of set a caveat of the only entity or beings or spirits, it kind of depends what you believe in and what you're working with, the only energies, spirits, etc. that are welcome within this sacred space are ones who have my best influences in mind, are willing to lend assistance, etc., however you want to phrase it. Or the reverse. Nothing is allowed within this circle that intends to interfere in a negative way with my working, with me, or there's lots of ways you could phrase that. Energetic concentration. I do mean a couple things by that. In casting your circle, you are essentially setting up a spherical boundary that, like I said, not only blocks unwanted influences out, but it can also keep things contained. So on one hand, you have all of this energy that you are raising, you are charging, you are building up, and for the time being, until you so choose to release it, it's kind of keeping it contained. You're working within this highly charged sort of controlled maelstrom of manifestation energy that you have created. Remember, circles are really conducive to movement and flow. On top of that, as it's keeping all of that energy and your working contained, you then, at the end of your spell or ritual, after you've done all of the steps in it, you've spent time focusing on your intention, charging everything up, doing everything you need to do, reciting your incantation, you know, repeating your words of power, you release the circle, you open it up, and it just, boom, blasts all of that energy out in one burst. Which for a lot of people, it feels like it really helps with those long, kind of more arduous rituals, really helps kind of shotgun it out into the universe. And then there is setting the mood. Now, regardless of whether or not you live in a place where you have a dedicated physical space for your magical work, for practicing your craft, by casting a circle, like I said, it's also referred to as opening sacred space. So you are temporarily dedicating space to your workings. Not only does this act as a means of blessing the space you're about to work in and saying, hey, this is what this space is currently being activated for, but it also helps you get into the right frame of mind, which I've talked about that a lot in other videos about kind of getting into a magical mindset. I can link that video down below. I think that's really important and really crucial for success of magic, is just feeling magical. Here is a list of some, not all, some types and methods of circles and how to cast them. Just as whether or not you actually cast the circle comes down to personal preference, as well as maybe a tradition that you happen to follow, so does the method with which you use to cast it. Again, that might come down to your tradition, it might come down to your personal beliefs, or what you involve in your practice, or just what feels right, or maybe sometimes just what you have time for. I'm just going to lay out some of the most common techniques and the very general steps of casting a circle. This general info should be enough to kind of get the ball rolling for you, but if you have any questions, always leave them down below in the comments, and I'll try to get to as many as I can. And unless you have a tradition that is dictating, like, hey, you should do it this particular way, and you feel the need to follow that, like, word for word, then I do recommend that you experiment with a few different types of these methods and just feel out which one works for you. Before you begin, make sure to ground and center. If you are not sure what this is or how to do it, it is also part of this introductory series that I'm making, and so the video to that will be linked down below in the description box. Regardless of which method that you use later on, you are going to need energy for it. Traditionally, a circle is cast by moving in a clockwise direction. Now, depending on your space and which method you use, this may be you literally walking around a room or a large space, or it may be just you kind of like working in the section and then working in the section and then, you know, and so on. In many traditions, now you would be starting off facing a specific direction. Very commonly, that would be facing the east. However, I always say, unless you actually follow that particular tradition, and if you do, then you probably already know what you should be doing here, then don't really worry about it. You can experiment with that, of course, but don't feel like that's a rule that you have to commit to. I always feel that words can lend a lot of power to our actions, or at least projecting words, you know, thinking them in our head and kind of projecting that intention outward as we are going through the motions. If you are unable to speak aloud for any reason, you know, you're practicing in secret, don't want people to hear, somebody sleeping, etc. Any reason you may not want to speak out loud. But I do recommend, although you don't have to, but I do recommend you just say a little something. You can have it pre-written and planned out, or you can just kind of say it, whatever comes to mind, comes to your heart at the time being. You could say it before, during, or after, but it just gives, like I said, intention to your movements and to your actions. I don't really have anything dedicated because, like I said, I don't cast circles that often, to be perfectly honest with you, but I would maybe say something along the lines of, I cast this circle as a barrier against any unwanted and unhelpful energies and entities, a container for manifestation and an amplifier of my power. With these words, this space is blessed. The circle is cast. So again, that could be before you begin the motions, it could be during, or you could say it afterward. But of course, as always, more important than words is always just intention. Whichever method you choose, as you are going through the steps of it, just keep in mind the purpose of it. You are putting energy, maybe items, but definitely energy into place. You are defining that sacred space, defining that circle as a means of protection, concentrating your energy, etc. Certain things are welcome in, other things are banished out. These are your intentions for this. And then pick your method. Let's start with a physical circle. Now, just because you are going to be using physical items for this one doesn't mean that it's not also an energetic circle. You are still casting as you go, which means you are creating an energetic boundary with physical representations of that as well. You would put items in a circle on the ground around you, or perhaps, you know, if you're working in a room, you might have some tables set up in each corner, and so you put an item on each table to kind of represent, and then the boundary of the room is, you know, I mean, it's a square, but you could still use kind of corners for it to help set up a boundary, just like a compass, right? You have north, east, southwest, but you know, it's still a circle. So again, items either just in a circle on the floor or up, you can have it raised up, that's fine too. You could have a boundary of sticks, candles, stones, lay it down, paint it on the floor, or use chalk. Salt is a very popular one. Or if you're working outside in grass, maybe use crumbled up white eggshell as an alternative. We'll touch on this a little bit more later because this is sort of a separate thing, but you can also put different symbols in each section. I think the classic Hollywood one is like a bunch of candles, right? Which of course is the coolest, also the most dangerous. But as always, the possibilities here are endless. Again, you would still need to use energy to cast your circle. So you could visualize as you're placing your items, energy coming to life with that item being placed. Or you could place them, get it all organized in exactly how you want first, and then walk the perimeter. And using, you know, visualization, as well as you've already grounded and centered, so you have an energy supply. And if you wish to manipulate that with your hands, you can, or just project it outward into the space. You can physically charge the items up. There's a lot of different ways to do this. Of course, like if you're working with candles, it's as simple as just, you know, lighting the candle and deciding that now that section of the circle is activated. Once you reach the other side, again, you're moving in a clockwise fashion, your circle has been completed. Another option is to draw your circle in the air with a tool, such as a wand or an athame or sword. A broom, sweeping the floor with a broom, of course, is always a classic. And then, of course, there's your number one tool, which is just your hand. Using your hand, finger, two fingers, whatever, you would just, again, walking clockwise, moving around the perimeter of your circle, you would be using your tool or hand to draw the boundary of your circle. One of my favorites is the visualized circle, which is probably the simplest form of circle casting. I also really enjoy it because it works very well if you work in a tight space. If you don't have enough space to walk around and walk the perimeter of an entire circle, maybe there's furniture in the way, or you work in a very tiny place, like a closet. You're a literal broom closet witch. Then yeah, you can't be like strutting around with your athame, just like, nah, 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 or putting things out. It just doesn't work. And yes, I'm gonna admit it now, this is highly debated, but personally, I have never found it to be an issue if your sort of energy bubble is overlapping with furniture. If furniture or inanimate objects in general are intersecting your circle, your little spell space, your bubble, that's okay. There's still energy completely surrounding it and passing through it. So no, maybe you can't put down an actual chalk line on the floor, but that doesn't mean you can't still cast a perfectly functional circle. With this, you would simply go straight from grounding and centering to visualizing as you feel that energy in your center begin to expand and grow. What it looks like, what color it is, what temperature it takes on is completely up to you. Whatever positive protective energy looks like to you, that might be golden glitter, it might be brilliant white light, it might be warm, it might be cool, like stone or marble. So whatever that feels and looks like to you, just work with that energy, visualize it, and feel it expand from that little ball in your chest. Feel it expand outward until it is completely surrounding you, wide enough that you can go about your working. Maybe you have a little table in front of you that you have your ceremonial items on, your spell ingredients. Again, don't worry. If the foot of your bed is in the way and the bubble is dissecting that, no problem. Another option, if this is something that you believe in and something you work with, is to call on spirit. Whether that is your deity, whether that is ancestors, whether that is literal spirits, whomever, however your relationship goes, that you reach out and speak to them, you can simply, you know, pray and call upon them, asking them to bless your space and surround you with a protective boundary. Another one of my personal favorites when I have the space for it is the elemental circle. This one is very often set up using the directions northeast, southwest. And in each of these corners of your circle, you would be calling upon the element that corresponds with that direction and asking them to enter your space, lend you energy, and provide you protection, or something along those lines. In my opinion, it always works better to be polite and request that presence, request that assistance, not demand it. And I know it helps, at least for me, mentally helping me kind of get in the right zone and get in touch with who I'm reaching out to, right? It helps to have a physical representation of the elements. So a representation for earth, maybe a plant, water, might be a bowl of water, literally. It could be a seashell, sand from the beach, fire, a candle is a very easy one for that, but there's alternatives, and air, incense, or a feather. Those are just a few quick examples. I have seen so many different versions of what what element corresponds with what compass point direction. So I'm not gonna tell you, like, this is what it is, because that would just be one version of it. If you follow a tradition that does have a specific guideline for this, then wonderful, go with that. You can also use your gut. You can also just completely disregard the compass, pick four corners, and just, you know, whatever. One is earth, one is air, one is fire, one is water. Done. The way I view it is that, like, literally any direction that you face, you're going to find every single one of the elements. In my opinion, it really doesn't matter because the elements are everywhere. So like I said, with this one, face your starting direction, whatever you choose, whichever element you choose to start with, and call upon that element politely, hopefully, inviting them into your space to provide protection and assistance. Assistance, of course, isn't required, but hey, may as well ask for a little help. And then, of course, you would walk clockwise to the next point of your circle and repeat. The last one that I'm going to cover today is the calling of the directions, or the calling of the quarters, or the calling of the guardians, or the guardians of the watchtowers, whatever you want to call it. There's lots of different terms. It covers a lot of different practices and traditions and paths, and also eclectics. You don't have to follow a specific tradition or path to do one of these. It really comes down to personal preference and belief. I don't know how many times I've already said that in this video, but they're all very, very similar. They just go by different names and slightly different styles. They're also kind of in the same vein as the previous one, the elemental circle. However, in this version, calling of the directions, hence the name, the actual compass point directions do matter. Additionally, when we talk about the guardians or the guardians of the watchtowers, for some people, that is sort of an ambiguous statement. It's sort of like a whoever's out there, or it's meant to be more symbolic rather than calling upon an actual entity. For other practitioners, it is archangels, or, and this, again, like I said, it overlaps, but I didn't want to put them as one and the same. It could be elemental spirits. But I do like to kind of say, like, calling of the quarters using elemental spirits is different than making an elemental circle. Just a little bit in regards to belief and practice. Facing the direction that you are starting in, you would call upon that corresponding guardian, or just that direction in general. And just like with the elemental circle, you would request their presence, inviting them into your space and asking that they provide protection and assistance. In some traditions, the caster may draw a pentagram in front of them as they are asking that. They are using the energy of that drawn pentagram and kind of expanding it and pushing it outward into that direction, visualizing it almost like a shield or a magical emblem. Just like with drawing your circle with a tool, you could just use your fingers, use your hand, or you could use a wand or athame, a sword, a flower, whatever. And then, as I mentioned earlier, maybe this is the point when you want to say something, if you didn't say something in the beginning or during, or maybe you said something earlier, but you want to just sort of finalize it by, you know, saying the circle is cast. That's it. Your circle's cast. Now, while it's best to stay within the circle until you are completely done and ready to open it and release it, and this is highly debated, touch on that in a moment, life happens. Sometimes you go through all these steps of casting your circle, opening sacred space, and then you're like, I gotta pee, or I forgot the matches. Like I said, this is a surprisingly controversial topic. Different practitioners have different beliefs about this. I can only tell you what I feel based on my own personal experience, and I recommend that you experiment with it for yourself and see how you feel about it. Some believe that when you step through a cast circle, it destroys it. But others feel that you could use your hand, fingers, or a tool, and either sort of you could draw a door that you then open and step through. Do what you gotta do, grab what you gotta grab, re-enter through that same door that you created, and then seal it back over. Of course, the focus needs to be on resealing it and projecting out energy in order to kind of heal that broken space. You could also, I mean, it doesn't have to be a door, it could be like curtains that you swipe to the side. Like I said, I personally think that you should try this out for yourself, try it out on different circle casting methods, and see how you feel about it. Maybe you feel like your circle is a bit weakened. That's okay, recast it. Now you know, lesson learned, don't do it again. Use a bathroom before you start. Or you may say like, hey, I really feel like this energetic patch, so to speak, that I've put over this door that I opened really did the trick. It sort of melded back into one and we're good. I feel like my circle's as strong as ever. Then great. I would still say like always do your best to stay within the circle and not have to spend more time and energy doing that sort of thing. But you may find that it's not the end of the world. You don't have to start from scratch all over again. Just because like you forgot to grab the yellow candle, you grab the white ones instead. And finally, how to open up your circle and release it once you are done. This part is very, very simple. However you cast your circle, whatever method that you used, you are essentially going to do the same steps backwards. If you invited an entity into your space, asking them for assistance and protection, then you can, you know, thank them for their assistance and protection and let them know that their presence is no longer required. Basically, they are free to go. You would work in a counterclockwise manner for releasing your circle. I personally always like to say something. I'm a talker, if you couldn't tell. But of course, it's not a requirement. I would keep it simple for the closing because at this point, everything's done, your energy's been spent, and you're just finally kind of letting it all go. So I would say something along the lines of, I open the circle and release the energies within. And there you have it. That's everything. I have to go because my baby just woke up from her nap and is crying. So thank you all so much for being here. Those videos that I mentioned throughout this video are linked down below in the description box, as well as the article that corresponds with this video. So feel free to check those out. There's also probably a couple over here, and I'll see you guys next time.